Hey everyone, welcome back to RM Transit. I was actually on vacation last week, and no, I'm not a normal person, so I didn't spend my free time thinking about, I don't know, the meaning of life. I spent it thinking about transit, and I came up with an interesting thought. The main thing I was thinking about is how we think about transit frequency, and the question of whether it really is everything. If you aren't already, consider supporting the channel on Patreon. You get access to behind the scenes, private chats, early release videos, and other stuff, and you help me bring you more videos like this on a regular basis. So what has me thinking about frequency? Well, everyone in the public transit space knows that frequency is really important, but being car-free, I kind of wonder whether the importance of frequency is something that is sort of elevated by this car-centric way that we look at public transit, particularly in North America. And to be fair, I, when talking to people in public transit, do feel like people in North America are more obsessed about frequency than in other places. I think it's interesting because in Toronto, we are really obsessed with transit frequency, and Toronto happens to be a very car-oriented place. It's an interesting thing to consider. Of course, with a car, you can go wherever you want, whenever you want. But that isn't necessarily how people who exclusively use public transit, or even largely use public transit, operate. Public transit users think about schedules and different routes and disruptions and trade-offs in a way that car drivers simply don't. Of course, none of this is to say that frequency isn't important. It is. Just that frequency's importance may be sort of exaggerated by public transit users who also have access to a car and who think that anything less than a 10-minute frequency is unacceptable. I feel like I've felt that way in the past because I've had a car in the past, and I think that that sort of changes the way you think about public transit, and I think that once you spend a lot of time living without a car and without access to one, you really do think about transit differently. Now, the question came up for me because of a trip I frequently make from my home in the suburbs of Toronto to central Toronto. It seems like a popular idea for some people in the space that people don't actually care about traveling to downtown that much, but I find myself doing it a lot because downtown is where like tons of amenities and different things are, so I just find myself going there a lot. I basically have two options. I can take the TTC, which has a couple possible routes and really high frequency, and since there's a couple routes, each of those frequencies on those routes add up, so there are buses that I could take every couple of minutes that will take me to downtown Toronto, or will take me to the subway to take me to downtown Toronto. On the other hand, another option I have is GO Transit, the regional rail operator in Toronto, and interestingly, despite the much lower frequencies on GO Transit, that's the option I find myself taking most of the time these days. I think the reasons that I choose to take GO Transit, despite having the TTC as an option, can tell us a lot about what drives people's decisions on which transit trips they make, how they choose what transit options they use, and what generally people think about different trip options. To be clear too, I still take the TTC from time to time, and often what I'll do is take GO one way and TTC the other, because I'm weird and like riding a diverse set of transit routes, but I don't think most people operate that way. Now I want to start with what I think is maybe the most interesting tidbit, and it is a bit of an aside. Why is it that I love the hourly GO train service so much when an hourly bus back in Vancouver would give me a migraine? It doesn't make a lot of sense at first glance because I'm mostly mode agnostic. I'll take whatever option gets me to where I need to go. So why is it that I find the train trip so much better than the bus trip? I think there are a few reasons, but the biggest of them is what I would call the frequency-consistency trade-off. What I'm saying here is that I'd venture some transit riders would be willing to give up some frequency in order to gain some consistency. Basically, I'm willing to deal with a less frequent transit service if I know that the service will show up when it's supposed to consistently. Now, this is something GO does shockingly well. Using various train lines, especially recently as I went to Hamilton and I actually made some other trips recently on GO, it's very interesting how GO is really reliable in terms of scheduling, and they don't seem to pad as heavily as they have in the past. I mean, I spend time tracking trip times and tracking how long we dwell at stations, and it's not actually that bad. Despite this, you can show up at a station and the train basically always shows up within a minute or two of when it was supposed to, which is kind of mind-blowing when you're used to riding buses that can sometimes be plus or minus 20 minutes from when they're scheduled to come. I remember riding a half-hourly bus in high school, and it was way worse than this hourly train. It was just incredibly inconsistent. You would show up sometimes, the bus would get there 10 minutes early, and you'd have to run to catch it. And then other times you'd show up and you'd be waiting there 30, 40 minutes, even though this is a 30-minute frequency route, because buses get delayed or buses bunch. What's incredible about having a service that just shows up on the minute when it's supposed to is that you can really plan around it. You know, if you're sitting at school or if you're at home, you can say, hey, I'm going to leave at exactly the minute I need to leave so that I can walk to the station, and if I get delayed, I'll have, you know, a 2 or 3 minute buffer. It's incredible. With the bus in high school, I basically just had to go because I didn't know when it was going to show up. That sort of freedom means that effectively you're gaining a lot of time back, which is sort of the same benefit you get from high frequency. Basically, the benefit of high frequency is when you show up at a station or stop, the vehicle comes shortly. And the great thing about having a consistent vehicle arrival or departure time is that you kind of get the same benefit. You just have to know when to leave. This is doubly interesting because what it means is that there is an almost free change we can make to our transit, getting it to run on schedule better, that will bring us massive benefit, again, without spending money. Even more important, this can be applied to low frequency routes in particular to make them a lot more usable and useful to riders. Now, I do think there are other things that make the regional rail trips so enticing, and I'm going to break down the pros and cons here. Now, taking the TTC, as I mentioned, I can start my trip within roughly 5 minutes, no matter where I want to go. And unless I time the GO trip, the TTC trip will often be faster. The TTC trip is also less expensive, something that is frequently brought up as an incredibly important point about transit. Mind you, again though, I think this often, yet again, comes from the perspective of people who have to spend money on a car and maybe also spend money on transit, or people who have some other components to their transportation budget. When you're car free, I think the difference in fares can be somewhat less substantial than you might think when you're not car free. Of course, when I ride GO, I get a bunch of benefits, and many of those benefits, as I sort of inferred, are benefits that aren't necessarily appreciated very much within transit spheres. Consistency, comfort, the ability to go on my phone for the entire trip. It's a real benefit when you're spending, you know, half an hour to an hour making a trip to be able to use your phone and check Twitter or check your emails. Follow me on Twitter, by the way. I tweet lots of interesting stuff. Having guaranteed access to a seat and having nice places to wait on both ends of your trip are also super nice. Of course, GO Transit, regional rail in general often, is much, much faster. And what that means is that if I time things right, I can shave an hour off my commute by taking GO instead of the TTC. For me, that hour saved is worth the dollar extra I have to pay for the fare going both ways. Now again, I'm not saying frequency doesn't matter, but I do think we have a ton more to learn from people who choose between transit options, not between transit and a car. When we look at everything through the framework of a car, we think different things are important than we would otherwise. Another thing with regard to fares that I think about is, if you had a car-sized transit budget, I don't think you would care about fares all that much. Now, social fares are incredibly important for those who can't necessarily afford to pay a premium fare for a regional rail service, for example. But I think it's overblown how important small differences in fare costs are when the average Joe who owns a car and has to pay for insurance, gas, and maybe car payments, etc., probably doesn't care because they could buy a month pass on 2 or 3 agencies for the same cost that they pay for a car. And so again, if we can create a really compelling transit system, I think fares are actually less of an issue than many think. Again though, we do need things like concession fares for certain groups of people. I think students and seniors, for example, should receive concession fares, as well as a comprehensive social fare program. Now, as I mentioned before, speed is really important, but what about stations? This is something that there isn't really an equivalent for in the car world, and so I don't think it often gets brought up. We're constantly comparing, especially in sort of public relations media for transit projects, how X project is this fast and it's going to be X percent faster. But we don't talk about stations because I think most people, especially in North America, think about things in terms of travel time, because stations aren't something that's relevant to car drivers. But for me, the regional rail option, literally a decision to make a trip, often comes down to these stations, and without the stations I have access to, I think that would make or break the trip. If I couldn't sit down in a nice climate-controlled seating area with access to shops and food and snacks and stuff at Toronto Union Station, one half of my trip, I think that it would be way less compelling for me to use regional rail. The same could be said for if the trip was unreliable, it would be way less compelling. Again, we often think about nice stations as a waste of money when compared to basic transit service, but for actual transit riders, a nice station provides a lot of benefit. I know of a lot of TTC stations where I typically just have to stand when I wait for my next vehicle because there isn't all that much seating. And I'm not suggesting that subways need to have tons of seating or that they should, I'm just suggesting that these are benefits that we don't always consider. So yeah, better basic service is usually going to be the better investment, but when you look at things through the lens of a transit rider, a nice station is a big bonus. Anyways, I thought I'd make this video to point out what I think are some misconceptions, and so that I could speak about my own experiences riding both regional rail and local transit. Of course, I can only speak for myself, but I do always go out of my way to talk to other riders, especially when I'm, you know, waiting on my train, to get a sense of why they're making the certain trip choice they're making. And more often than not, I hear the same things. Comfort has value, reliability has value, connectivity has value, and of course, speed has a lot of value. And if you provide a good service, people will use it, even if it has a more expensive fare. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.